Hello everyone, and welcome back to Screenwriter's Pitch. This episode is going to be a little different than before. The last episode was a pitch for a film that has yet to exist, but this time I'm doing a rewrite for a film that has released. And of course, you saw the title, today we're tackling Wonder Woman 1984. To say that the response to the film was mixed would be charitable, let's just say. And this rewrite aims to address many of the criticisms levied at the film. But before we start, I'm going to have to address that thumbnail. You probably looked at it and thought, 1977, what's that all about? Well, yes, I've decided to shift the setting of the film by a little under 10 years. I'll get into the reasons why a bit later so as to not drag out this intro any further, but just know that there is a reason for it. Anyway, without further ado, I present to you my rewrite of Wonder Woman 1984 that I've entitled Wonder Woman 1977. The film opens in present day, 2020. We fade in on a rock. The rock is picked up by an excavation archaeologist. A group of armed goons are holding this team at gunpoint. The lead thug snatches the rock and knocks out the archaeologist. The goons all leave the room and lock it to prevent the archaeologists from escaping. They all enter a convoy of armed vehicles and drive off. The archaeologists scramble to find a phone or any way to get the SOS out, but it's hopeless. There's nothing they can do. Suddenly, a slam at the door, and another, and another. They all fear the worst. The goons have come back to finish them off, or worse. The door slams open, but to the archaeologist's surprise, it's Wonder Woman. Diana helps up the archaeologist, who is now regaining consciousness. Are you all right? What did they take?
The stone. They took the stone.
What stone? Another archaeologist gives Diana a piece of paper detailing much of their research on this stone.
This stone. We believe it holds a great power. It can't be left in their hands.
I'll get it. You stay here. Diana rushes out of the building. The convoy rolls through the snowy mountains. One of the thugs, stationed on the turret, spots something in the distance.
Is that?
Oh my god. Diana speeds towards the convoy. The machine gun fire is quick to commence, but she deflects it with her cuffs. After disabling all but one of the trucks in the convoy, she uses her whip to fling herself onto the main truck. She demands they hand over the stone. One of the thugs picks it up.
Let's try this out. I wish Wonder Woman would stop following us.
Diana is confused. Suddenly, a tree in the way of the path knocks her clean off of the vehicle and sends her flying down the mountain. She's able to catch herself with the lasso, but she's lost the truck and the stone. We cut to the interior of a large room. It's very dark, but we can discern some large screens and scaffolding and drapes scattered all around. A dot lights up on the main screen, an incoming call. A man makes his way over and presses a button on the keyboard. This man is none other than Bruce Wayne. Diana explains the situation and asks if Bruce can track the convoy, something to which he replies, all he had to do was ask. He also informs her that he's sending Alfred on the Flying Fox to pick her up. We cut to the interior of a small Los Angeles apartment. We find an old man and his son. The latter hands the former a beer and they start talking. Scattered all throughout the apartment are little hand-built gadgets and gizmos that the old man has made over the years. In this conversation, the father asks a series of questions to his son, but the son only gives half answers. It's clear their relationship is quite strained. We learn here that the mother died a number of years ago. The father is trying his best, but his son is ultimately too resentful of the fact that he feels he never got the attention he deserved until the old man needed help. It's too little, too late. The father tries to explain that he did his best to raise his son,
but the latter rebukes this by ranting about the fact that he was rarely ever around and that his mother practically raised him alone. The son angrily leaves, berating his father as a man who cared more for his useless inventions than his own son. He really is nothing but a con man. Cut back to Diana in the Flying Fox. Alfred exits from the cockpit, having left the ship on autopilot. They exchange in some friendly banter as Alfred pours the two of them some coffee. As Alfred does this, she talks about how she always wondered how her father was able to make Themyscira invisible to the world. She explains that she's been trying to learn how to do it for years, but has only been able to do it with small objects. She demonstrates by turning the cup of coffee Alfred handed her invisible. Is this your way of telling me you don't like my coffee? The old man stands in a shady back alley. He is joined by another old man in a wheelchair, pushed along by a young woman. He calls out, finally giving us the name of the old man. Maxwell Lord, long time no see. Max turns to the old man in the wheelchair with surprise. John, I'm so happy you could come. Who's this? This is my granddaughter, Emily. Granddaughter? Has it really been that long? Almost 50 years. Time flies, doesn't it? Yes. Yes, it does. So, tell me, Max. Why did you want to see me after all this time? Well, I just wanted to catch up and, I also wanted to show you something. Max opens a back door and brings John and Emily inside. They enter a warehouse with the convoy of trucks inside. What's this? Max explains that he spent the very last of his savings to acquire a very specific item. This doesn't exactly answer John's question, but Max is deliberately keeping information from him. Max enters the truck and grabs the rock before walking back to John. A rock? This is what you wanted to show me? It's not just a rock. It's so much more than that. Suddenly the garage door bursts open. It's Wonder Woman. She's tracked them down. Max orders the armed goons to stop her. Ensues a fight between Wonder Woman and the thugs. As this is all happening, Max rushes over to John. John, I need you to tell me something. We need to get the hell out of here. Can we do this later? Wait! John, don't you wish we could go back? You know, be young again? John is panicked at the sight of the gunfire going on. Answer me! Well, of course I wish that, but it just simply isn't possible, is it? Max smiles. He got what he wanted. Diana notices a large gust of wind, and a white light brightens. She attempts to grab the rock with the lasso, but the vortex is too strong. She lunges at Max and reaches out her hand. The white light covers the screen. Diana wakes up in a Los Angeles apartment. She feels a sense of deja vu looking at the walls of this place. She gets up and looks out of the window. She can't believe what she sees. Afros, mustaches, bell-bottom jeans, and overly large collared shirts. The camera pans over to a calendar on her wall. July, 1977. And that's Act 1 of Wonder Woman 1977. We'll get to the date change in just a bit, but first let's go over the more significant changes. And the biggest of those changes, obviously, is time travel. In the original Wonder Woman and in BVS, it is said rather explicitly, even by Diana herself, that she hasn't been Wonder Woman since World War I. But Wonder Woman 1984 wants to have its cake and eat it too. So what they do is they have Diana being Wonder Woman, but she destroys a few security cameras, which even in the 80s were capable of recording video, so destroying them wouldn't really matter. This would be fine if Diana hadn't herself said that she didn't do this, but alas, here we are. Therefore, a lot of people, upon watching the trailers, figured that there would be some sort of time travel involved to explain why Diana is doing Wonder Woman stuff
during a period where she claimed she didn't. The film elected not to do this, but for this rewrite I've decided to go this route because if you want to have your cake and eat it too, this is how you do it. By having Diana go back in time, you can have a Diana who has learned that stepping away from humanity may not have been the best idea, and has embraced being Wonder Woman again in a time period where her past self wasn't ready to do that. The only wrinkle with time travel is the notion of having two of the same person at the same time. If past Diana saw another version of herself parading around as Wonder Woman, she might have some questions and it would probably bring her out of her exile, which would cause a number of complications. But there is fortunately a form of time travel that helps me kill two birds with one stone. This is the Days of Future Past method, which consists of having someone's consciousness put into their past self. This both avoided the two Dianas problem, as well as tie directly into my reworking of Maxwell Lord's arc. In my rewrite, Lord is an old man who wanted to be a great inventor and aimed to change the world for the better. He spent more time with his inventions than his own family. But unfortunately, none of his inventions ever caught on, and he ended up being a failure in not only his eyes, but in the eyes of his family. I won't give away what his plan is just yet, but one thing I wanted to emphasize with the use of it was having Maxwell seeing his life as wasted and the fantasy that we all might have, which is to wish that we could go back and do it all again. And this wish is here fully realized, but at what cost? So then why 1977? I wouldn't have changed the date if the 80s were central to the story of Wonder Woman 1984, but the truth is you really could have just set it at about any time after the invention of the television and you'd be fine. Only very surface level elements would have to be changed. But why specifically the 70s then? Well, I noted that the creators of the film were going after a Rich Donner Superman vibe with the film, they've even said as much. If that's the case, then what they're going for is set in the 70s, right? At least for the film that is considered the best. And even Superman 2, which was released in 81, was filmed back to back with the first Superman in the 70s, so making it more of a 70s film than it is an 80s film. Additionally, making it the 70s makes for a great throwback to the classic Linda Carter Wonder Woman series, which itself was released in 77. The Bruce Wayne cameo serves two purposes. First, finding a convenient way to get Diana from the snowy mountains back to Los Angeles, and second, give a brief where are they now scene to show the audience a glimpse at the new Hall of Justice, which was teased at the end of Justice League. Diana steps back from the window and takes a moment, realizing what's just happened. Is this a dream? How can this be happening? She gets herself dressed and walks out of her apartment into the hallway and bumps into her neighbor. The neighbor talks to Diana, just rattling off on how she's been working on sewing together this dress and yada yada yada. Diana stops and asks her who she is. The neighbor responds, "Oh, sorry, you must not remember me. I'm Barbara, your neighbor," obviously. Diana says that she needs to go, and she walks out to get a good look at the world outside. She's still coming to terms with what she's seeing. She walks up to a TV store and watches the TVs and finally understands when and where she really is. This is true. This isn't a dream. But something catches her eye. On one of the screens, she sees Max Lord. Except he looks younger. Much younger. Max is teasing the announcement of a big new invention. The event is tonight. We cut to said event. Diana makes her way inside in a nice dress and enters the crowd. Max Lord comes onto stage and the audience claps for him. Lord makes his big announcement. He talks about a great technological revolution and how he intends to be at the forefront of it, to propel the world into the future. Finally, Max Lord's invention is revealed. The audience gasps and cheers, and Diana goes along with it at first, but eventually, after looking at it for only a few seconds, her expression changes. She recognizes what this is,
anyone from the year 2020 would, but seeing it here in the year 1977, something is off about it. This isn't right. The camera cuts back to the stage, as we see what appears to be a contemporary laptop. It is at this moment that Max Lord spots Diana in the crowd. The two lock eyes, a mutual understanding that both of them are in a time and place where they don't belong. We cut to the after party, and Max is enjoying drinks with a group of wealthy benefactors. Diana walks up behind him and asks to speak with him alone. Max is clearly relishing this moment with all of these rich investors and doesn't want to have to stop this conversation. But Diana insists, and Max comes up with some excuse to be left to talk with Diana. The two have an incredibly heated and tense conversation, all the while trying to keep appearances up, such as to not cause a scene. Diana is asking question after question as to how she got here, and how he got here, and how any of this is possible. Max tries to brush it off by simply saying that he made a wish, nothing more. But this attempt at deflecting Diana only causes her to be enlightened as to how this came to be. She remembers the thug in the truck chase in the mountains, when he grabbed the rock and he made a wish, and immediately afterwards, she got thrown off the vehicle. She prods Max, demanding he hand over the stone and undo all of this. Max asks her a question. You've lost someone, right? Someone close to you? Tell me, if you had the power to wish for anything, wouldn't you wish to have them back? Diana, somewhat reluctantly, responds, Yes, I would. Who wouldn't? But you can't possibly think that this is somehow the same thing. You're messing with time, with the lives of billions of people. Max looks around. An air of regret begins to seep over him. He turns to Diana and tells her that while he doesn't have the stone with him now, she can meet with him tomorrow morning in his office, where he will return the stone, at which point he will let her do with it whatever she sees fit, including the undoing of everything he's done. Diana agrees and walks off. The camera pans down as we see that Max has been holding the rock this whole time. We cut back to Diana in her apartment. She holds in her hands a small wooden statue of an owl. She stares down the owl with fierce concentration. The opacity of the owl begins fluctuating until suddenly it vanishes. Diana is still practicing her ability to turn things invisible, a hereditary gift from her father. She sits back and takes a sigh of relief, but a sense of unsatisfaction brews underneath. She wonders how it is possible for her father to have turned all of Themyscira invisible, and yet she's been practicing for months and has failed to do anything close to something of that scale, though perhaps it is a muscle that the her of 1977 has yet to work as hard as the Diana of 2020. Suddenly, a knock at the door. Diana knows she isn't expecting anyone, so she's rather confused. She calls out, asking if Barbara is the one at the door, but instead, the voice of a man is heard. It's me, the man says. Diana gets up, weary. She worries that Max Lord might have followed her home. I'm not expecting any guests. Who are you? Diana responds. The man only responds with, It's me, Diana. Diana slowly approaches the door, with a clenched fist, prepared for anything. She opens the door to find Steve standing in the doorway. The expression on Steve's face as he sees Diana is worth a thousand words. Diana's is one of sheer bewilderment, but that feeling is quickly washed over with the reopening of so many old wounds. She spent so long trying to forget Steve. And now that he's standing right in front of her, she can no longer hold inside the emotions that she's hidden for the last 60 years. She violently wraps her arms around Steve and can barely contain the tears. Another door opens. It's Barbara. She asks if everything is okay, and Diana quickly retreats so as to not be seen in this state. Steve picks up the slack and, with both confusion and curiosity, asks who she is. Barbara introduces herself as Diana's neighbor and inquires as to Steve's identity. Steve stumbles on his words as he tries to figure out a suitable explanation. Barbara picks up on what Steve is trying to get at. Oh, right, I see. But how come I haven't seen you around? I mean, Diana's lived here for over 2 years. I mean, we don't talk much, but I've bumped into her here and there, and I think I'd know if she had a boyfriend.
An awkward silence befalls the hallway. Barbara continues.
I mean, we have thin walls here, so Steve cuts through the awkwardness of the situation by telling Barbara that he's a pilot in the US military and that he's been therefore away for a few years.
Barbara asks, how many? Steve responds, almost 60 years. Barbara laughs, interpreting Steve's response as a joke about how long it has felt since he last saw Diana. Steve turns back to look at Diana, who is doing her best to act as casually as possible while wiping away the tears streaking down her face. But now that I'm here, feels like not a minute has passed.
Barbara butts in. Hey, would you guys like some tea? I was just making one, if you want, of course.
Cut to a few minutes later inside Barbara's apartment. We see drapes and cloths everywhere. A spotted cat crawls around the place. While brewing a tea at the kitchen, Barbara apologizes for the mess, reiterating her hobby of creating various outfits. In the living room, Diana explains to her best abilities how this situation happened. Max, the stone that wishes time travel. She tells Steve about Max's agreement to return the stone and accentuates the importance of stopping him, before the timeline is changed too drastically. Steve questions Diana's naivete in believing that Max would so easily return the stone, given all the power it holds. People with power will stop at nothing to keep it. If Diana is to go meet with Max, she shouldn't expect it to go down without a fight. This gives Diana an idea. She walks over to Barbara and asks her if she could make a dress for her, the occasion being a party the next day. Barbara, eager to help Diana in any way she can, agrees without a second thought. Diana quickly sketches the design, a very rudimentary depiction of her Wonder Woman attire. The next morning arrives, and Diana is putting on a long coat before heading out. As she's about to leave, Steve stops her and tells her that he's coming along. She objects, but Steve insists. He knows that she is strong enough to not need any backup, but he has to see Max in the flesh. Diana eventually agrees and says that, in that case, we should get you ready. Ensues a quick montage, much like what we saw in the film, where Diana has Steve try on 70s clothing. The montage continues as the two go outside and make their way over to Max Lord's office, along the way marveling at the progress in technology of the last 60 years. They arrive at Max Lord's office, and Max excitedly greets Steve, both surprised and glad to see him, and to see that his plan has worked. Diana demands that Max return the stone, as he promised. Max, perhaps predictably, goes back on his word, and says he wants to hold on to it for a little while. Diana grabs Max by the collar, and tells him that she will not ask again. A man bursts in and points a gun to Steve's head. It is at this point that Max tells all. He reveals to Diana how he tricked her into bringing Steve back, and that the only way to keep him alive is to let him keep the stone. Diana is wrestling with right and wrong, her wants and desires, her duties and responsibilities. Max gently walks off, and winks to Steve as he walks out of the office. The man holding a gun to Steve walks away and closes the door behind him. Steve thinks Max is bluffing. But Diana remembers when Max goaded her into saying her wish, and figures out that she got tricked. Upon realizing this, Steve tells Diana that they need to go after Max and undo this. Diana refuses. She spent so long mourning Steve, and now that she's got him back, she can't just give him up. Steve explains that he knows and understands that if she undoes the wishes, then he'll die. But he reminds Diana of her hope and idealism, recalling her quest to kill Ares. She would stop at nothing to bring good back to the world then. There's no reason he should get in the way of her doing the same again. Let's get that stone.
Diana and Steve chase after Max and exit into the main lobby of the office building. Max is there, but so are a few dozen armed men. Guns raised right at them, blocking them from getting to Max. "Give me the stone, Max. If you want it, come and get it, Wonder Woman." Max exits the building, and Diana drops her coat, revealing a homemade Wonder Woman outfit made by Barbara. "Shall we?" A fight breaks out between Diana and the armed men, Steve getting a few hits in. As the fight goes on, Diana gets hit pretty bad. A bullet grazes her arm and she is more easily hurt. She can feel herself getting weaker until she's almost single-handedly knocked down by the last man standing, the wind knocked right out of her. The man aims his pistol at Diana and a gunshot resonates. The man falls to the ground, shot by Steve. Outside, in the bushes, Barbara is watching. She followed them here in secret. Somebody taps her on the shoulder. She turns around and sees Max. "What are you doing here, miss? It's not safe."
I was just curious.
"I hear that can be bad for cats."
A bag is suddenly put on Barbara's head, and she's dragged off.
Steve helps Diana get up and asks if she's okay. Diana says that she doesn't understand what's happening to her, why she's feeling so weak, but Steve realizes why. "The stone grants you a wish, but takes something in return. So the longer you stay alive, the weaker I become." "Max has an army. How are we gonna stop him now?" Diana takes a moment as she catches her breath. Suddenly, it dawns on her. Asteria.
And that's Act 2 of Wonder Woman 1977. I don't have as much to talk about here as a lot of this second act serves to build to the final act, so I'll have a lot more to say then. For the time being, let's dwell on a few small things. First of all, Steve. In Wonder Woman 1984, the screenwriters felt the need to come up with this rather over-engineered explanation for Steve's return, in which the mind of Steve possessed the body of some random dude. This was one of the most widely criticized things in the film, one major concern being the fact that Diana uses this man's body for sex without his consent. My guess is that perhaps in a previous draft of the script, this aspect would have been more pronounced, but for whatever reason, that development was cut and they just left this convoluted explanation in. Whatever the case may be, I decided to massively simplify this whole ordeal and have the stone simply bring Steve back. Because it's a big magic wishing rock, and if it's able to make giant walls appear out of thin air, then it can probably do the same for Steve. As for Barbara, there is still some development left to come, so I'll be brief. I decided to change her introduction into the story a little bit. Instead of being an obsessive co-worker of Diana's, I made the two neighbors, making Barbara more of a lonely, nosy neighbor type, as opposed to the somewhat more cliched, obsessive nerd character. And obviously, I couldn't help myself from adding a few cat references here and there, just for good measure. I wanted to exploit time travel for more than just the utilization of the time period, and actually incorporated it into the villain's plot. I figured that if I was going to put this element into the film, I might actually do something useful with it. As such, Max wants to use his knowledge of the future to be successful in the past. As he was a failed inventor his whole life, the notion that he would want to go back in time and invent popular things before they were popular is something that I'm sure a lot of us have thought about. Act 3 begins with an Indiana Jones-style montage, with Diana and Steve traveling across the world, making their way to Greece. Meanwhile, back in DC, Max knocks at the door of a house he hasn't laid eyes on in a long, long time. His old friend, but now, in his youth, opens the door. The two greet each other, and John congratulates Max on his big announcement. Max casually mentions with much pride that he's been offered a meeting with the president, but Max, bolstered by the magnitude of his innovation, has asked the president to meet him in his brand new office inside of the recently completed World Trade Center.
John, more than impressed by Max's invention, asks a ton of questions about how he got the idea and how, concretely, he built it. Max diverts the question, making John suspicious, but John trusts Max, so he assumes he's just a little cagey about his work. Max asks John to come with him to New York. John agrees. Diana and Steve trek up to the Acropolis, and they sneak past the tourists into an abandoned part of the area. They go down a dark series of tunnels, all the while Steve talks to Diana. But she's so focused on her goal that she barely hears him. Are you ever going to explain what this Asteria thing's all about? They reach the door and Diana tries to use her strength to open it. But she's growing weaker and is struggling, barely managing to crack the stone. She keeps going at it over and over until Steve grabs her and demands that she answer him. You said Max needs to be stopped. We're trying to avoid the end of time, right? So why are you bending over backwards to do it? You're weak, Diana. I'm causing it, can't you see that? Diana responds that that is exactly why they're here, to get something that'll give them an edge. Steve responds that she already had the edge over Max. She's giving it up to let him live. Why are you so hell-bent on breaking me? Diana responds. I'm doing all this for you. Because I don't want to lose you, not again. This time I can do something to keep you, and I'm not giving that up. And I am beyond grateful for that, Steve responds. I just don't know if I'm worth all this, Diana. You are worth all this, Steve, because I love you. Diana musters up all of her strength and punches her fist straight through the wall, shattering it to pieces. They enter and Diana narrates the story of Asteria, while Steve looks up at the murals, telling her story.
Her name was Asteria. She was our greatest warrior. When mankind enslaved the Amazons, my mother freed us. But someone had to stay behind to hold back the tide of men so the others could escape to Themyscira. My people gave up all of their armor to make her one suit strong enough to take on the whole world. And Asteria sacrificed herself for a better day for others.
They open the tomb and pull out a golden suit of armor. Max and John get on the plane. Once it gets into the air, Max asks one of his men if the cat has landed. The goon confirms, and Max consequently tells John that he needs to make a quick call. Diana and Steve finish packing the suit into the trunk of the car. Suddenly, a ring is heard. Steve is very confused by the noise, but Diana recognizes it. That's a phone. A phone? Where? It's in your jacket. Diana reaches into Steve's breast pocket and pulls out a mobile phone. Steve is stunned. Diana picks up. Max, I assume?
Correct. I see you're very quick to adapt to this technology.
I am when it's technology that's not from this time. Touché. Listen, I know you're a smart woman, so I know it won't take much for you to track me down. Not with all of the world's news preparing to cover my meeting with the president.
What are you planning?
If you really think I'm about to show you all my cards, you've got another thing coming. But I will give you my ace, should you care enough to take it.
What are you talking about?
Your feline friend. She needs your help. What have you done to her?
Oh, I didn't do anything. I merely granted her wish to be as powerful as you, Diana.
Where is she?
Much closer than you'd think. I'll send you the address, but for her sake, I'd suggest you show up soon.
Max hangs up. John inquires about what the hell Max was just talking about, and Max once again avoids the question and brushes it off.
Diana and Steve arrive at the location. It's a massive interior zoo, a greenhouse. Steve tells Diana he's going to go inside to find Barbara, giving Diana some time to prepare. Steve enters the botanical garden and looks around. We see a POV shot from the bushes, like a predator hunting its prey. Barbara suddenly jumps out at Steve, but she isn't Barbara anymore. She's become the cheetah. Cheetah attacks Steve. He tries to defend himself, but is completely overpowered by Cheetah. She goes in for a finishing blow, but is stopped by Diana, who flies in and tackles her out of the way. Diana tries to reason with Barbara, but in her animalistic state, her cognitive abilities are little more than raw emotion, barely able up to muster up a few words. But what little she is able to say reflects how betrayed and lied to she feels. Diana tells Barbara that this can be undone, but Cheetah simply responds,
"No, you did this to me."
The two fight, Diana using her ability of flight to her advantage. She remains in a more defensive position while Cheetah goes on the offensive. Diana is able to use cunning to get the better of Cheetah's animalistic tactics. Despite losing her wings in the battle, Diana is still able to get the one-up over Barbara by electrocuting her. Barbara survives, but is badly hurt. Steve tells Diana they have to leave. Diana gently caresses Cheetah's head and tells her that it's going to be okay. She's going to make this right. In the car, Steve turns on the radio, not before marveling at the fact that such a thing is even possible. On the radio, the anchor announces that
there are less than 12 hours before the 4th of July celebrations.
Along with this, he announces that
as a part of the celebration, President Jimmy Carter is going to host an event with Max Lord on the roof of the World Trade Center.
Steve asks, "What now?" To which Diana responds, "We need to steal a plane."
She packed my bags last night, pre-flight.
Their car smashes into the local airport.
0 hour, 9 a.m.
And drives down the runway.
And I'm gonna be a rocket man.
Police see this and order they be stopped.
Get us up there?
Yeah. I just have to pick up speed first and then I'll take off.
The way I fly, it will never find us.
Steve confidently pilots the jet, in spite of his mild confusion at all the modifications within the fighter jet over the last 60 years. He claims that it's just like riding a bike. And it is at this point that Diana is able to fully utilize her abilities of invisibility in order to hide the plane from the world, like her father did before her. The ceremony is underway on the roof of the World Trade Center. Max and the President laugh as the marching band plays their tune. When they're done, the President makes a short speech, introducing Max before he walks up to the podium.
Max makes a grand statement, a testament to his own genius, claiming that his innovations are here to change the world. John sits on the side and sees something shine in Max's pocket. It's the stone. Max tells that sometimes all we need for our dreams to come true is to make a wish. In this moment, he introduces his longtime friend, John. John walks up to the stage, and Max puts his one hand in his pocket and the other on John's shoulder, something that John picks up on. Max asks John what his wish is. But John, by this point, is on to Max. He may not understand quite how Max has been able to do the things that he's done, but he knows Max better than anyone, and knows that he's cheated his way to fame. John, in a somewhat poetic fashion, wishes that everyone has the power that Max does. The audience may not have quite understood what that meant, neither did the people watching the broadcast, but Max understood, and his expression fades instantly. As John walks away, the audience cheers, but Max stands in fear of what is about to happen. At this moment, the fireworks begin. Max looks in the distance and thinks he sees something, but he's not quite sure. Before he can make out anything, he sees that the president is being informed about something. The Russians have suddenly gotten into possession of hundreds of more nuclear warheads. The president and his team then rush off. Max looks to the streets and chaos is beginning to break out. And in that moment, he begins to regret his actions. He never meant for anything to go this far, he just wanted to get rich and famous. The sound of a jet can be heard flying overhead, and as soon as it passes, Diana lands, having just jumped from it. Give me the stone, Max. This has gone far enough. Max cowers in fear and orders his men to kill her. The audience panics and flees, heading down the stairs, while Diana faces the hordes of armed men at Max's disposal. The jet that Steve is flying is running out of fuel and begins to glide. Steve steers the plane towards the Hudson. He activates the ejector seat right as the plane hits the water. And safely lands on the shore, from where he can observe the chaos erupting from the streets. After some fighting, Max manages to slip away and makes his way to the stairs, but before he can enter, Steve emerges and a fight between the two begins. Diana's suit is protecting her well, but the power of all these armed goons is too much for her, now that her natural powers have depleted entirely. She begins to be swamped and entirely overwhelmed. Steve sees this and puts Max in a chokehold as he gains the upper hand. Max taunts Steve, asking him what his greatest wish is, not that it matters anyway, now that everyone has the power without him. Steve and Diana share a final look. Both know that the time is now, but also know what the cost of saving the world is. Steve grabs the stone from Max's pocket and makes his wish. I wish for all wishes to be undone. Max lets out a no in defiance, and a tear goes down Diana's face, with Steve giving her a comforting smile as the screen fades to white. Diana wakes up in her room. She recognizes it. She's back in 2020, back in the present. She puts a finger to her face and wipes away a tear. She gets up and walks over to the window to view the New York skyline. She can't believe what she sees. Outside the window, things are much like how they are now, but slightly more advanced. Flying cars, holograms, cybernetic augmentations, and the Twin Towers are still intact. It appears as though, although everyone was returned to their normal time, the timeline remains changed by what happened, with technology having been advanced by over 50 years. And as Diana looks on in wonder at this brave new world, the screen cuts to black.
What a wonderful
And that's Act 3 of Wonder Woman 1977, and this concludes my rewrite pitch for Wonder Woman 1984. Let's start by tackling the major differences between the film and my rewrite, and from there I'll talk more about my intentions creatively. It's important to view it through this lens because it's the same lens I used to make my rewrite. My approach was to go over the major complaints levied at the film and find a way to resolve them all in a neat and satisfying way. First, let's look at the characters, as that's where any good story derives from. Diana's journey in Wonder Woman 84 was about accepting the time-old idiom that we can't always get what we want, and that the truth is more important than even our greatest desires. I very much wanted to keep this aspect true in my rewrite, as there is absolutely no problem with this arc in principle. But what I changed was the journey Diana takes to get there. I've mentioned before how I discarded the weird body swap thing with Steve, given that not only does the film never address this as a moral and ethical problem, to, you know, hijack a man's body and life for your own selfish desires, but the consequence that Diana faces for getting Steve is that she loses her powers. So it's not even like the body swap thing was the consequence. It just exists for absolutely no reason other than to raise a myriad of questions the film has no interest in answering. So I cut that out in favor of drastically simplifying things and just having Steve be resurrected, since there is no reason given that the stone couldn't just do that given the things that it is able to do. But the big change in Diana's arc is in terms of her wrestling with the consequences of keeping Steve alive. I knew that I wanted to find a better use for the Asteria armor than what Wonder Woman 84 used, in which the armor is used by Diana for no apparent reason other than because it looks cool, I guess. And don't get me wrong, the suit is cool. Really cool, in fact. But, and I'm not the only one to have pointed this out, it would have made far more sense narratively for Diana to use this suit of armor to compensate for her diminishing powers. Her wearing it after renouncing her wish and thus not only regaining her full powers, but also gaining the ability of flight immediately afterwards, thus making a suit with wings not a requirement for her to fly, rather pointless. So I decided to move Diana's regaining of her powers to after the final battle, not before. That way she has a perfectly logical excuse to wear it. Also, I figured showing her finding the armor would be a lot more satisfying than her just having collected it already off screen. This also meant that Steve would remain alive until the very end, as Diana has not yet renounced her wish. This gave the perfect excuse to have Steve be a part of the final battle, fighting with Max while Diana fought the armed goons at Max's disposal. When it comes to the denouement, Diana renouncing her wish, I had Steve be the one to do it for her. This serves as a nice parallel to the first film, where Steve made the sacrifice play to save the world. And I felt this would be a nice mirror to that moment, with Steve ready to remove himself from existence if it means saving the timeline. However, as the last look the two share suggests, Diana recognizes that this is the right decision, and even though she doesn't vocalize it, she accepts to renounce her wish and lets Steve undo all of the wishes, thus undoing hers. Moving on to Barbara.
Her character was the toughest to figure out a fix for. My first goal was to attempt to take her away a bit from the archetype of the nerdy friend, just a little bit, giving her a more nosy but well-meaning neighbor kind of personality. And of course, including small allusions to her inevitable feline fate in a way that, granted, isn't very subtle, I'll admit, but is at least, I think, better than her simply noticing Diana's cheetah print heels and deciding, yep, that's gonna be my supervillain persona. Cheetah still serves the role she did in Wonder Woman 84, being basically a obstacle in the way of Diana getting to Max, providing him with some time to put his master plan into motion, but obviously the location is changed. Her fate is left deliberately unclear, though one could easily assume that she simply turned back into Barbara as all the wishes were undone. This decision, by the way, of having Steve undo all the wishes wasn't just about him undoing Diana's, but was, of course, a way to address another criticism levied at the film, that being that it's fairly unbelievable that literally everyone would undo their wish, especially considering that many people may have wished for entirely altruistic and selfless things. But by having Steve doing a blanket undo under the clear goal and understanding that even if some of the wishes may have had good intentions, the consequences are too grave to keep them and must be undone. And finally, Max. I've talked a bit about his revised arc in my rewrite before, as he's the character with by far the biggest change. But now that we've concluded the story, let's review. Max's arc is the story of an old man who feels his life was wasted, and consequently decides to go back in time and get rich and famous by anticipating modern technology. His hope with this is that his family, and indeed the world, will finally respect him. But what he fails to understand is that the reason his relationship with his son is strained is not that his inventions were never successful, it's that he puts his inventions over his family. The irony being that Max could have gone back in time to undo this mistake and spend more time with his family, but he was so focused on his inventions as the reason his life failed, rather than realizing that his priorities were the problem, that he never gets that second chance. As I mentioned earlier, this was a way for me to tie in the time travel aspect of the film with the themes of the film in a neat way. But that does, of course, beg the question, why the time travel? Well, for me, the decision to go with time travel was necessary to accomplish what Wonder Woman 84 clearly wanted to do, to have their cake and eat it too. I didn't intend for that to rhyme, but there you go. In the movie, they couldn't reconcile with the fact that her being Wonder Woman during the 80s was in direct contradiction with what Diana stated she did between 1918 and 2016, that being not acting as Wonder Woman. Wonder Woman 84 tries to address this by having Diana break security cameras to hide her trace, even though the question was never that Diana stayed simply hidden for 100 years, but explicitly that she wasn't active as Wonder Woman during this time. She says quite clearly that it's Doomsday that brought her out of, you know, quote unquote retirement. So by bringing in time travel, we're able to have a story set in the past while also not contradicting anything that came before, as Wonder Woman's return to the world of man happened earlier in the character's journey. And this also means that we didn't have to worry about the question, how come nobody references these events ever again? Because, as this is technically a new timeline, the consequences of changing it, while still important, won't affect the established events of the larger DCEU. This brings us naturally to the ending. Now, I'll admit, this ending is in large part there to tease my pitch for Wonder Woman 3, but it is also one that I think makes a lot of sense given the events that have transpired. The way I look at it, the Wishing Stone undid all the wishes, but it still had to make a compromise in order to not end up causing a paradox. That paradox being, of course, that if the stone made it so that none of the events ever happened, Diana and Max would never have gone back in time to set in motion the events that would lead to the Wishing Stone undoing said events. Look, it's time travel. It's never going to make any sense. But my take is this. The stone created a compromise. Diana and Max's minds are returned to their present day selves, as if you recall, the form of time travel used is that of transporting one's mind into their younger self, thus avoiding duplicates of oneself at one time. But the stone couldn't undo the events that took place, so the stone essentially cancelled all the wishes, but couldn't go back to make it so that they never happened. They did still happen, and everyone will remember that. But the wishes are undone insofar as they are no longer active. Logically, this means the timeline would still be changed dramatically, but Diana and Steve were still able to keep the timeline on course and successfully stopped the entire human race from annihilating each other. So, even though the timeline was changed, the day was still very much saved. There are some smaller details that I included, such as the use of 70s music and the use of landmarks that no longer exist in the modern day to serve as an effective contrast between the then and now, as well as highlighting the change in the timeline at the very end, but I'll let you all uncover the finer touches throughout the pitch for yourselves. And that's going to do it. Thank you all so much for following this episode of Screenwriter's Pitch. It truly means a lot. I hope you enjoyed it, and I would love to read your thoughts on my pitch, or even read your own pitches for a rewrite in the comments below. And if you want to see more Screenwriter's Pitch, I suggest you give this video a like. It'll really help us out. And if you don't want to miss the next episode, then you should definitely subscribe. Thank you all for watching. And I'll see you in the next video. Goodbye.